afternoon, everybody, and welcome, of course, to the Mara Triangle for this, the final installment of the September Mara Spectacular with Safari Live. My name is James Hendry. In case you didn't know, on camera today, Jean Dre. He is not going to show you his grubby thumb because it is under... Oh, it is. Look at that. He washed it. Very nice. He's about to wash it again, of course, in the rain. As you can see, it is coming in from the eastern side of this magnificent reserve. In fact, it is already falling in the southeast, it would seem. This is unaffected, or it has not affected the zebra and the wildebeest over here. And we've just stopped at this point so that we could give you a bit of a view of the great diversity, the scenery, the rain coming in, and to tell you that there haven't been any crossings today that we've managed to find. We've been to the main points that we went to yesterday, where we saw all that astounding action. And then off to this side is the last crossing point we're going to go and have a look at, and we'll see what happens there. Then... the lions. We've had some interesting lion stuff going on during the course of the day. We found two new lions we haven't seen before. They seem to be quite interested in hunting fairly soon. So with any luck, we'll follow them at night. I think that's going to be our best bet. The Kichwa Tembo Pride, who we saw yesterday, fast asleep. They still seem to be fast asleep and most satiated. And then we met a new seven lions recently. They were off sort of underneath where it's just started to rain over there, and they are not doing very much at all because they, like most of the other cats in this area, have eaten themselves into a Sunday lunch stupor, even though it's Saturday. It is Saturday, isn't it? Yes, it is indeed. Then we've got some buffalo off to the right-hand side of where you're now looking. But mostly, before we go and look at the buffalo, we're going to show you Graham Wallington's very favourite animal. That is the topi. There is one topi in front of us there. Well, it was. It is now behind a large vehicle. Oh, well, that is disappointing. Oh, Graham, there it is. Go. Super zoom that topi, Jean-André. There it is. Oh, look at that. I think these things are amazing. And there are subspecies of the sesame, which we do find in the Kruger from time to time. Lots of them in the Okavango in Botswana. The sesame, that is. And the topi up here, very fascinating, mainly because nobody really understands its social structure. It's apparently got one of the most variable social structure of all the antelope species. Sometimes a harem situation, sometimes they move in great herds, sometimes with the migration, often they're resident here. It's really rather fascinating. So I'd like to spend some more time with topi. Unfortunately, Graham Wallington, who of course, as you all know, is responsible for my employment, he thinks topi are, well, not quite as exciting as some of the other things that we have on offer here in the Mara Triangle. And as he's sitting in the back of the car, well, we must just do what he says. Joey, you want to see an eland, and you say, is this the last opportunity? Well, it might be the last opportunity for this particular time, but we've actually got an eland in front of us, spotted very kindly by Tyler, who is the general manager of Angama Mara, where we're staying, quite possibly the most beautiful lodge in the world. I cannot see the eland, however. Tyler is an American, so his eyes are better designed than mine, I think.
Straight up the road.
Ah, got it on the ridge there. There you go, Joey. There's an eland, courtesy of Tyler. Isn't that lovely? Now, they inhabit the ecotone regions. That's where you see it there. An ecotone, the sort of gap, if you like, between, or the place where two vegetation types meet. So they're like the woodland where it moves into the grassland. And you will see them, obviously, moving across the grasslands. But those eland are sitting in the ecotone. Aren't they gorgeous? Thanks for that, Joey. That is the continent's biggest antelope. I think the Lord Derby's, which you can find in Queen Elizabeth Park in Uganda, is slightly bigger than this one. And that's, I think it's just a subspecies of this eland. Aren't they lovely? Eland, I suppose, is what I should be saying. Eland is the Afrikaans pronunciation. I got shouted at that by Mr. Graham Wallington yesterday evening. Lest I be hauled in front of a disciplinary commission, I better say it correctly. Eland. And a big bull weighs up to 750 kilograms, which is round about 1,800 pounds, which of course is many pounds in anyone's language. Now, let us drive a little bit, Gendry. Is that okay with you?
Quite so.
He says, quite so. It's very nice that he's actually speaking today. Sometimes he doesn't speak at all. Well, I mean, look, when we're not live, that's a benefit. But when we're live, it's nice to hear from him every so often. Not too much, though. Okay, you can see that it is still an absolutely beautiful landscape, just because it is in East Africa and because everywhere you look, it's stunning. Sandy, you'd want to know if we've seen the baby Thompson's gazelle that we saw crossing the river yesterday, today. No, not as far as I know, Sandy. I just need to give you an idea, Sandy. My camera is on the roof. Thank you very much for that, Rebecca. What an idiot. Not Rebecca, me, I mean. Let's go with this again. Sandy, the area we're driving is so vast. It's so much bigger. It's the size of the entire Sabi Sand. So for us to find the individual Thompson's gazelle fawn or lamb that came out of the river yesterday would be almost impossible. This was the area, though, that it was in. But I think, Sandy, that it either joined up with a herd and is fine, or it has been devoured by a predator during the night. It would be very difficult to say, even if we saw one the same size, whether or not it was the same one. There are the eland, Joey in Australia. There's a lovely view of them for you, sitting on this rocky knoll where there's some trees. You can see them browsing there. So they're quite adept mixed feeders, are the eland. Clearly able to browse and graze. They look to be in, well, relatively good nick. That one looks a little bit skinny, a bit hippie. But they are stunning. And quite adaptable, you know. They live in this area, which is fairly well watered. You can find them all the way into the Kalahari in southern Africa, which is, well, it is a desert, semi-desert to desert. And they survive there very well. This is our first proper eland sighting. Very nice. Okay, let's move on. There's just a little, the crossing is just down the way here. And we'll just have a quick look at it and see if we can't find some of those gormless crocodiles. While we drive along here, let me share you some of my impressions of the crocodilians here. It is my firm impression that a crocodile is one of nature's most dim-witted creatures, having seen what they do during the course of the day. Yesterday, we watched one raised its head out of the water before any animals had got into the water. There were wildebeest and zebra massing to come across the river, and this idiot stuck his head out of the water and they all ran away and then crossed unscathed at another crossing point. Then the day before that, we watched a crocodile lying exactly where I'm going to take you now, also in front of a herd of wildebeest on the sand with his mouth open facing him, as if to say to his lunch, please run into my mouth. Needless to say, not even the wildebeest, which is supposedly renowned as one of the most gormless creatures in Africa, not even the wildebeest would fall for a trick like that. It is a little bit rattly, I apologize for that. Like I've said before, the vehicle we are driving is, it makes Wendy, Rusty and Jigger look like utterly youthful and wonderful animals. Right, we're just going to quickly pop down to this crossing here, and if there's nothing, well, if there's something there, we'll come back to you. If there isn't, we'll find something else. So let's head across back to the Nkohuma Pride with Jamie Patterson, and we'll catch up with you shortly. While we're watching this, that is a Defassa waterbuck that you're looking at. You can see its bottom is fully white as opposed to just circularly white like the ones back home in the Sabi Sand. Very nice. The youngsters, as Gendre pans off to the left and then zooms in, there they are. Much like the waterbuck we get at home, look like little donkeys. And this is the same species, it's a different subspecies. Isn't that a gorgeous scene? I know it's a bit rainy, but it is still very pretty indeed. I might have to take a picture with this enormous cannon I have here. Cannon, I mean, as in weapon. Now, I took two, you will have heard. As you come back towards this swampy area, there's a very large goose. And you see the goose, Gendre? That's him. That is a spur-wing goose, everybody, and as far as I'm aware, Africa's largest goose. He probably stands, oh, I don't know, if you were to stretch him out, if he was to stretch his neck forward, I reckon he's almost 4 feet long. Then, also in this area, as Jean-Ray zooms out a little and then pans to the left, we have a sacred ibis, which is normally a sort of aquatic animal eater. There it's eating, probably looking for frogs and things. And yesterday, however, the sacred ibis that we found was stealing bits of wildebeest from a crocodile. It was a very brave sacred ibis, of course. I think they're magnificent birds. I'm sad we don't see more of them at home. Then, Jandre, if you didn't mind coming back to the right-hand side, you can see some jacanas. Just keep going right past the goose and zooming in over round about there. You should see a jacana or two there. Middle of the screen, you've got a jacana. That's the same version that you see knocking about on Arethusa Dam when there's water in it. A lily trotter with its very long toes. You can see how long the toes are there, actually. And then there's also a pied kingfisher hovering. Look at that. With the most perfect scenery behind. Stay there, bird. I'm going to take a picture of you. Oh, I got it, everyone. Should be quite fun. How cool is that? Jandre, that's beautifully done. Well done. That is very cool indeed. And there he sits on the edge of a little branch. Then I did see what I thought was a pygmy kingfisher, but it may have been a malachite, but I think it was pygmy. The only reason I'm a bit confused, there it is. It is a malachite, actually. Is it? I've lost my mind. Let me get my bird app out. Jandre, you stay there on that one. We know that's pied. Can't mistake that. It's black and white. It's malachite. I'm getting confirmation from the ornithologist / general manager of Angama that it is a malachite kingfisher. Now, Jandre, where it is basically if you pull out from the pied and go into the middle of the swamp, there is a small group of sort of reedy-like sticks sticking out to the left. Zoom in to the right of the goose. There. Zoom in slowly there and I'll direct you. I think those might be the very sticks. Yep. Just keep going in there. No, they're not the right sticks. Go right a bit at that level. Keep going. Keep going. Keep going. No, I think you've gone too far. Sorry, everybody, this is quite difficult to try and find because I'm sat in the car. Okay, you see the jacana, Jandre? Yeah. Just to the right of the jacana, there, and further to the back of the swamp, there's a little thing of sticks. Okay, to the left. We've got him now. Keep going to the left. Tyler spotted him. There he is. You got him. Beastly bird. Right, malachite kingfisher. That's very nice. And a rather splendid scene. And let's zoom all the way out, if you don't mind, and we'll give you an idea of exactly where we are. There's the Olulolo escarpment that I have to sort of pause before saying every time. Absolutely astounding picture we have here. Isn't that gorgeous? And there the rain falling in the south and the east. Kathy, you want to know what an escarpment is? I've always just known it as a sort of mountain range or rising that goes up to a plateau. So this goes on to a plateau that slopes gently down towards Lake Victoria, as far as I'm aware. But we'd call the Drakensberg that you can see from the Sabi Sand an escarpment. And basically it's the rising of land once you move away from the coastal plain up onto a plateau. That's, as far as I can understand it, what an escarpment is. Thank you for that question, Kathy. Mostly, of course, because I haven't thought about how to define it for so very long.
What an astoundingly gorgeous scene, yet another one. It's very difficult to find anything in this place that you want to look at that you don't think, yeah, I don't think that's very nice. Except, of course, in the case of Mr. Wallington when he sees a topi. Gorgeous stuff. Righty, well, I think we'll press on from here. We're going to head towards those lions, the earlier lions that we saw, everyone. Apparently, may or may not, it's very difficult to tell, may or may not have killed a zebra. We're hoping that the zebra was not killed by them and that they're not going to eat it and that they're going to kill another one. Not because we don't like zebras, but because we'd quite like to catch them killing live, because that is, after all, one of the major reasons that we came to this area. That is the sacred ibis. Hello, Cat in Tampa. You say that the sacred ibis makes 100 birds for you, and you want to know if you're allowed to combine your Sabi sand and Mara bird list together. Cat, you can absolutely. I give you full permission to do that. Well, it's all on the African continent, and if you were a worldwide birder, then you'd have a life list that consisted of all the birds you'd ever seen. So you can have a safari live bird list, and when we're eventually watching hyacinth macaws streaming overhead around the jungles and clearings of South America, well, then you can include those too. Of course, that's if we can get Mr. Wallington to stop at the hyacinth macaw and not move on towards the jaguars. The smell of rain is in the air, everybody, and I don't know if you've ever been around, I'm sure most of you have been around a swampy area like this. I think that they just smell lovely. They smell very fertile. A slight, I suppose, fishy whiff in the air, but that's quite pleasant out here. As the soft pitter-patter of rain slowly drenches Jean-André, who has, oh, he has put on his raincoat. That's very unusual. That's very good. Now, James Richard, you're wondering if those Defasa waterbuck smell the same as the ones we get back home. I've driven past quite a few of them, I've got to tell you, and I don't remember smelling that very nice sort of peaty, musty smell. So I don't know. I wonder. Alrighty, Jean-André, let us press on from here. I have got the roof back on, everyone. It is raining, so you will be unable to see me. There you are. I'm just under that. I'll knock on it for you. There you are. That's me greeting you. Hello, Raccoon. You want to know if Graham is holding the umbrella again? Graham is holding the umbrella. This is the, well, I mean, it's the quintessential sort of definition, if you like, there he is, of the servant leader. Graham has spotted a heron. The fact that he has decided to stop for it means that he's probably very sick. Is it a Goliath? It's a Goliath heron, everyone. Say when, Jean-André. Okay. Gosh, that is magnificent. That is the Goliath heron, everyone. The largest, unsurprisingly, with a name like that, of the heron species. Certainly the ones we get here. I don't know if there are any bigger ones in North America, are there? Not this big. This is the biggest. And he's very patiently, well, A, shaking water off his feathers. Look how he's able to close them back onto his body. Isn't that amazing? And very patiently trawling for fish. I'm sure he'd take frogs very happily as well. Now, when I say he's big, obviously it's very difficult for you to tell from where you're looking now. I think he's probably from the tip of his toes, if you were to stretch his neck and his beak out, not far shy of 5.5 feet tall. He might even be slightly taller than that. No, just call him 5 and a half if you stretched him out. Good. That is a very nice spot. I'm just having another quick look through the window here. There, well, you can see Gendre's technical efforts at attaching the infrared lights. Well done, Gendre. Beautiful work there. You can see Gendre, very neat. I hope that VM Doornbruck doesn't see that. Let's head across to Jamie Patterson. She is still sitting with the Nkahuma Pride in their little cubbies. Please give them my very best regards.
Little Nkahuma cubbies. James sends his best regards to all of you. What do you say to that? Little things? I don't think they're terribly bothered. Cute. Look at them. All settled down and thoroughly peaceful. If you missed our extended sunset safari a couple of days ago, we had the most incredible experience with them, and I'll explain a little bit. Halo, before we chat about that incredible experience, I mentioned that perhaps there's a possibility that the males are off making new little littermates for these little ones, and you want to know what will happen with those cubs. Will they stay with their pride, or will they join their fathers? And the answer to that is that they will stay with their pride. So what happens with a female is when she's pregnant, she'll give birth some...
Everybody is a rather interesting situation. We started off this afternoon, not with you, but we came past this area and found these two lions over here. And the two lions were sort of in the right place wind-wise for a herd of zebra. And we thought they might kill, we thought they might not. We heard of other lions, so we left them. And in the interim, what they did was kill that young zebra, disembowel it, seemingly, and then they came and lay here, which is somewhat worse, about 100 meters or 330 feet from where they killed it. And it's very strange indeed. We're not really sure why. They don't look very full to me. If we look at the, if we can go back to the lions there, Gendre. That lioness does not look well satiated to me. So, fascinating. I just think that they are all perhaps not very, you know, that none of them are particularly hungry. And so maybe they'll go back to it and feed later. Maybe they'll kill one of the wildebeest in the background there a bit later. That's possible. But what's also interesting, of course, is that the cousins and brothers and perhaps even parents of that zebra are still grazing behind it. So it's all rather odd. We're learning every single day that we're here, the strange things that go on in the Mara Triangle, how they differ from the things that happen on Cheetah Plains, for example. And thankfully the rain has stayed away from us so far. But I'm not sure how long that situation is going to persist. Now, we're looking at one or two dead zebras here. And James Richard, you're wondering about the mass of these zebras. You say you have read that they are smaller than the Birchall zebra that we get at home. This is the Grant's zebra, everybody. It's the same species. It's a different subspecies from the Birchalls that we get in the Saabye Sand. I would say it is noticeable that they're smaller. I'm not sure exactly what the mass difference is. I would say probably about 5 to 10%, if I was to guess. But I will check it up for you if you like. Yeah, probably about 10%. They're slightly smaller. The most noticeable thing for me about them is A, that they don't have any shadow stripes. So those are the stripes between the black and white, which of course the Birchalls down in South Africa do. They've got a sort of grey-brown stripe between the black and white bits. And also, they've got a very distinctively rounded nose. Now, I used to ride horses, And, well, I still do sometimes, but we used to describe a horse like that as having a Roman nose, a kind of bulge just at the bottom. And that's what these chaps look like. They look like they've got a kind of Roman nose, as opposed to the much straighter skull and straighter forehead of the Burchell zebra. If I was to choose one from the other, I would say that I thought the Burchell zebra from home was maybe a slightly more handsome animal than this Grant's zebra. But they are both very splendid, and they are, like I say, part of the same species. Just look at that. I mean, where on earth can you see a view like that other than here in the Mara Triangle? Obviously a little bit macabre with the recently deceased zebra in the bottom left-hand corner. Especially as it seems to be slightly wasted. But something will come and eat that, everybody, be it vultures or hyenas, those scavenging male lions from around this area. I'm not surprised they look full the whole time. These females kill. It's almost like they've kind of left supper on the table for the males and then gone off. Gone off on a girl's night out, made supper for their husbands. They're not very empowered. Jen B, you say, is it possibly too hot for them to eat right now? No, Jen B, it's not hot at all. It's probably about 20, well, with the wind chill, probably about 20 degrees Celsius, which is, give me a 1 second, I'll work it out for you, around about 70 degrees Fahrenheit. You can see blood on her muzzle there. You know, normally if a lion has had to expend an enormous amount of effort killing something, and they're too tired or too hot to eat, they'll lie next to the kill. They won't leave it and come down here. I tell you what I think may have happened here. There was a herd of buffalo around here, and I don't think there are any of them around here now. And I think possibly the buffalo got wind. Yeah, the buffalo in the background there, way in the background. I wonder if those buffalo didn't see the dastardly lions take down the zebra and then chase them off. That could well have happened. So we might see a kill later on if the buffalo decide that these lions shouldn't eat that zebra. Then it's possible. Maybe one of those wildebeest will wander too close. But certainly these lions, like the lions all over Africa, are absolute opportunists. So whatever comes too close to them, they will kill, regardless of whether they're hungry or not. But I think these guys are not unhungry. I think they are. Is unhungry a word, Chandra? No, it's not, is it? I think they are hungry and certainly could eat. And maybe they'll go back to the zebra, maybe they'll kill something else a little bit later. Sorry, the splendor of this place is boiling my brain. Well, that's an interesting one, Tracy. Let me retrieve my binoculars. Oh. You say, Tracy, you say that dead zebra looks quite fat. Could it be pregnant? I must confess to you, I think that's a rather good theory. Yeah, I think it is quite fat. We can drive around there and have a look. In fact, why don't we do that? Jean-André, would you like to do that? Jean-André went, I don't know what that means, so I thought just think we'll go anyway. I must confess, everyone, I had a very shocking experience just before we came live. Jean-André has taken his boots off and his foot was sitting on the back of my chair and I touched it. And that was, you know, it took a lot of courage for me to even be able to come live at all. How is this ditch?
It's a nice ditch.
Well, you may well ask, Rebecca, you say, why are his shoes off? Good question. No one really knows. And Jean-André has become mute, so it's not possible to ask him. Oh, I see. He says now that his mother taught him not to stand on the furniture with his shoes on. My mother taught me not to stand on the furniture at all. Let's have a quick look at her. You can see she's very distressed by the sight of Jean-André. She looks deeply stressed out, doesn't she? She goes back to sleep. The lions of the Mara Triangle do enjoy a good sleep, much like lions everywhere, I suppose. Ah, look how spotty she is on her belly. Now, I'm beginning to wonder, and on her feet, Gee whiz, she's maintained a lot more spotting, and I don't think she's that young. She's maintained a lot. Look at her nose there. I'd say she was about 3 years old with a nose like that, so she's quite young. We know that from the blackening. By the time they're six, especially apparently in East Africa, the lions have got completely black noses. That one's got quite a lot of pink on it. I'd put it about three, but that's the most spotting I've ever seen on an adult lioness. And I'm just beginning to wonder, Mr. Wallington, if this isn't the lioness that we saw the first night with those males. She was very heavily spotted.
But then who would be the other lioness?
Yes, Mr. Wallington, that is a very salient query at this stage of the game, to which I do not have an answer, I'm afraid. Okay, let's go and have a look at that zebra, the deceased one. Now, although this does look like a very easy place to drive through, there is the odd ditch. So we'll just drive very slowly and easily through here. But we've very kindly been allowed to use this particular area. It's just below Angama Mara where we're staying. And we've been kindly allowed to use it. And thankfully that is the case, because further south, where we were originally going to use, there are more rocks than you can shake a stick at. If you wanted to shake some sticks at rocks. And I'm sorry about the bumping around. If you're starting to feel nauseous, just shut your eyes and I shall tell you what's happening. Jean-André, are you feeling nauseous yet? Jean-André did have some nausea the other day after our lion hunt, but he survived, everyone. He has some very heavy anti-motion sickness tablets that he takes. Strong enough, apparently, to knock out a small horse. Right, we're approaching the site of the crime. I'm just going to warn you, everybody, I don't know what we're going to see around here. It could be fairly distressing. So I'm going to warn you that if you don't wish to see the gore, hang on, John, just wait a second, then you need to shut your eyes now. Because I think that the theory that Tracy had might not be incorrect. No, that just looks like a very large piece of cecum that's come out there. No, it's all right, everybody. I don't think there's a baby zebra. Well, there might be inside, but it's not out now. Jan, you want to know, as we look at this rather horrendous sight, why are there no vultures around here or hyenas? There is one vulture, and Jandri will show it to you just now. It's in the only tree, well, it's in the closest tree to us. Oh dear, we've lost battery.
Whoopsie daisy, I think we lost James there.
Warn you, look, it's not distressing, but it is disgusting. So if you are perhaps feeling a little peaky, or you've just had your supper, you might want to not look. Now, what we're looking at there, everyone, is the zebra's cecum. Now, for those of you who are interested in biology, I think that's quite an interesting piece of organ. Many of you will think that's absolute nonsense, but it is interesting because you actually have a cecum, but it's in the form of something called your appendix. And in a zebra, which is a hind gut fermenter, and this is not something we're often able to talk about, because zebras don't generally wander around with their cecums hanging out of their bodies. You can see there it's enormous, and that is the fermentation vat in a hind gut fermenter. So if you're a hind gut fermenter and you need to digest grass and vegetation, that's where it happens, as opposed to a ruminant, for example, which has the fermentation taking place in the foregut or the front stomach, the four-chambered stomach of the rumen, at least of the ruminant. The rumen is just one of those chambers. So I think that's quite interesting. And we, of course, have a vestigial cecum, and that is the appendix, which we know, of course, we can take out should it become inflamed and explode, which apparently is very painful indeed. Jean-André, do you still have your cecum? Jean-André still has his cecum, everyone. What a relief. Do you have your cecum, Graham?
That's when I last checked.
Yes. When he last checked, Graham had his cecum, which is excellent news. Now, let's pan around, because there's not really much else to say about that hapless zebra, which hasn't been eaten. But we can see there the wildebeest and the zebra in the foreground. And then I think, if I'm not mistaken, Jandri, those are buffalo in the background, aren't they? Yes, they are. And so that is my theory. My theory is that the buffalo chased off the lions before they could eat here, and that's why they haven't eaten. Now, what they'll probably do is come back at some stage and start eating this thing, unless the wildebeest and zebras start to lurk even closer to them. And, sorry, I'm just being distracted by a bird flying across the clearing onto the top of that tree there. There we go, where there is one single vulture sitting. And I'm just going to get my binoculars and see what that is. Tyler, any ideas? Tyler says brown snake eagle. I concur. And then there's a vulture next to that. Looks like a white-backed, I think. And in the background, the African thunder rolls. Mercifully, we have had no rain. Well, we've had a little bit of rain on us, sufficient to wet Jandre. But the rest of us have remained dry, which is excellent. Now, Jandri, I don't mean to cause you trouble. Well, you know that's not true, but I have to say it anyway. The lion's just sat up behind us. That is a horrible angle. Are you right? Can you do it? Or shall I move the car? He's quite an agile fellow, Jandri, for a man of car with calves his size. There we are. Beautiful. Stunning. And in the background, what we'd call a ring-necked dove. I'm pretty sure it's called a ring-necked dove here as well. You can hear it going broop, 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 in the same way that they do in South Africa. I've always found doves to have the most comforting calls. I don't know why. But perhaps that's why they're the birds of peace. And if you want peace in your life, everyone, as I've often said to you while fossicking about in Juma, an African landscape like this, where there is no sound other than the sounds of nature. Well, I've got to tell you, it'll fill you with a sense of peace the likes of which you've never had. Here come the lions. I think it's well worth waiting here. We did facetiously suggest driving over the top of the zebra so that the lions were forced to kill again, but then we decided that would probably be a little bit unkind, so we're not going to do that. We weren't, just in case you think I'm being serious, we weren't actually thinking about doing that.
Well, Jandri, no, we weren't actually thinking about
doing that. Graham says, no, we weren't genuinely actually thinking about doing that. Hello, Michael. You say, oh, how wonderful. You say this is your first Mara drive since we got here because you've been at school. Well, I'm sorry about that, Michael, but you're obviously very keen on this area because you say, is this the marsh pride or are they on the other side of the river? You've got it exactly. This is not the marsh pride. They are on the other side of the river. This pride, we think, is a pride known as the Out of Africa pride and seems to consist of two or three females, and there may even be some cubs. Two cubs is what we've heard, but because... I'll just give you a bit of an idea. Because around here, the woodlands often don't have any grass, at least any roads going into them. It's very difficult to sort of get off, and nobody goes off on foot to check. It's difficult to know exactly what the case is. But this is the Out of Africa pride. We've been following the Kichwa Tembo pride, who has strong connections to the marsh pride. Indeed, many of the females from there apparently are a breakaway of the marsh prides, Michael. So that's quite interesting. We'll probably go and see them a little bit later, especially if we think they might hunt. Isn't she beautiful? That's me taking a couple of pictures. Sorry about the sound. One day they'll make a silent shutter and I'll be able to fire off like a machine gun without you knowing about it. So, Michael, and then also related to the marsh pride, of course, Scarface the male lion. We saw him 2 days ago. What a magnificent beast he is. I think the biggest and most impressive male lion I've ever seen. And it was just fantastic to spend a bit of time with him. And And you would have known him from, of course, the Big Cat Diaries. And we've met his brother, Morani. And we've met the two usurpers who apparently tossed him out of here. The Blondies, we'll call them for now. The other four males of the four musketeers, which were... Oh, look at her. Which were Scarface, Morani, Sekior, and Hunter. There we go. I can't believe I remembered that. We haven't met Sekior and Hunter. We don't know where they are at this stage, but most probably back across the river with the Marsh Pride. There she goes. And you might just in the background be able to hear the zebra going, which is them alarm calling. I'm just going to watch out for the other lioness who's not coming this way, which is quite interesting. She is watching us. So, chaps, very small movements if you're going to move at all. I don't mean everyone at home. She's not that good. She can't quite see you through the lens. Isn't this amazing? Truly is an astounding landscape. Everywhere you look, there is something amazing to see. Lioness feeding here, just away to the right-hand side of your screen. You've got a huge herd of wildebeest, which are now, they've seen this lioness coming up here. Zebra, buffalo, the Ololo escarpment stretching up into the sky. Huge grey clouds surrounding us, dumping rain on this fertile ecosystem. Thankfully not dumping it on us just yet. Hello, Snoop. She's chasing some flies now. Snoop, you say how large of an... you say how large of an area are we able to traverse here in the Mara compared with that of Juma? Snoop, a huge area. We're able to traverse an area the entire size, well, about... 9,000 hectares smaller than the Sabi Sands. So we can move through an area of 51,000 hectares in acres. That is roughly 130,000 acres or so, which is quite impressive. And we can go anywhere there that we like. And that's the great joy of it, of course. Now, these zebra are starting to come closer. I'm just going to... John is going to stay on this lioness who's being slightly... And I must just reiterate for those of you who are sensitive, I'm sorry about this, but this is, of course, typical cat behavior. Coming, not interested, and the zebra and the wildebeest all moving slowly closer to make sure or to find out what's going on here. Michael in New York, very nice question from you, and I haven't seen it, but it certainly does happen. You say, have I ever seen a lioness injured badly by a zebra? Because, of course, they can kick. They can kick extremely hard, and it does happen that they get injured. I've never seen it. And I think in this ecosystem, it probably happens more often than it does in other ecosystems. And that's because, of course, they eat, I think, more zebra. There are more zebra for them to eat. Now everyone's alarm calling. I'm just going to be quiet for a while. Feel the wind blowing, I'm sure. I've got to tell you, the smell of this place is just, it's clean, it's raw. I can't smell the zebra cecum, thankfully. And it is Africa. Now, she's not full. She can definitely eat, and that's great. Means that she has not killed for no reason. Slowly now, the herds are moving closer. I think let's have a quick look at them, Gendre, if you don't... maybe not. I don't know what she thinks she's doing, why she's trying to drag it somewhere. There's no thicket behind which she can put it. There is a termite mound just behind us that I suppose she might try and drag it behind. And she's just watching the zebra now and the wildebeest. She's not huge, you know, so I mean, maybe she's not quite 3 years old yet. Maybe she's got a little bit of growing to do still. Now, I can tell you this is not the same lioness we saw on the first day, and I'll tell you how I know that. The other one's coming up now. I know that because it's not because of her spotting. It's because she does not have swollen teats like that other lioness did. And apparently the lioness with those two blondies on the first night that we were here, apparently she had just lost her cubs to those blonde males. Look at that, it's bizarre. Absolutely bizarre. She's not making any effort to open it up and eat it. Might be the fact that the wildebeest and zebra are moving closer. It's unlikely, I think, that they would try and chase her off here. She's not making an enormous effort to try and get in there, and that just indicates to me she's not particularly hungry. She knows she'll eat. If she loses this one, she'll have something else to kill fairly soon. Okay, Gendre, let's just quickly, if you don't mind, have a look at the herd and how they've come back up towards her. I probably haven't parked in the easiest place for old Gendre here. He likes a challenge, though. There they are. You can see them all looking up now as the lioness got up and came to this area. And they're all going... That's alarm calling. And you can't hear it because the ambient microphone is covered by the rain cover, which is, of course, extremely important because it would break were the rain to fall upon it. Might even electrocute Gendre, and then his hair would be even more unwieldy than it is now. Do you want me to move slightly? Are you happy here? He says, which I think means no, we're okay over here. All right, let's watch the other lioness. Here she comes now. Gosh, this is marvelous, isn't it? I'm watching the lioness, but look at the... Look at the view behind her. There, I caught a whiff, I'm afraid, of the zebra's cecum. It wasn't particularly pleasant. What you can see, however, while this lioness, I'll just tell you about it, while this lioness comes over here, there is absolutely no reaction from the buffalo to the lions as they've come here now. One or two have looked up, but the rest of the herd is gathering. I think they're gathering and snoozing because it's getting a little bit cold. I'm just taking some pictures. Hopefully we'll be able to recognize these lions the next time we come. And I'd love for you to try and pick up some distinguishing features. Take some screenshots. Let's get some distinguishing features. Obviously, those spots might fade a little bit, but these two lionesses are easy to distinguish from each other. One of them seems to be lactating, although she's got swollen teats, but she doesn't seem to have very clear suckle marks. You've all been watching, of course, the... This is bizarre. You've been watching the Nkuhuma Pride, and you know, of course, that they've got very, very obvious suckle marks. The area around the teats become... really quite worn. Beautiful. I'm just going to do a quick comms check with the final control. Rebecca, have we still got you there? Okay, good. There we go. Just making sure. Now, they're trying to get into the bottom, and that is the softest place for lions to get. So So that's probably where they'll begin, especially as the kind of first hole that they've made has been, well, it's kind of been, you know, hang on a second. The first hole that they've made has been blocked, obviously, by the guts that have come out. You know what? I don't think these lions killed the zebra. I'll tell you why. I got a story from one of the guides earlier today that said he had seen a zebra in this area that had died around here. It tried to do a crossing the other day, was grabbed by a crocodile, came into this area, and its guts had started to come out. I think this is that zebra. I don't think they killed this thing. They've definitely had a go at it. But I think the swelling there that you're seeing, and the fact that it already doesn't have quite have rigor mortis, perhaps. I think they're scavenging here. That's quite interesting. Hello, Ravi. You say, it seems as if there are less flies around here than you'd expect. Are there less flies in the Mara, or is it perhaps because it's a fresh kill? Ravi, I think that it's I think it's because of the weather, largely. I think it's quite cool at the moment. The wind is blowing, which means the flies are generally fairly inactive. And so I think that's why you find that there are no flies here. There were some. You saw the lioness initially trying to snap at some of them. So that's quite an interesting theory I now have, having just remembered that, because I don't see how otherwise it would have been disemboweled like that and why they'd be struggling like they are to get in there. I had forgotten completely that Wilson from Angama Mara had explained that he'd seen a zebra around here that had clearly been attacked by a crocodile at some stage. So that's what we have here, I think. Which would explain, I'll tell you what else would it explain, while that ridiculous lioness holds the head up. It would explain, and that's because she's young, I think, that she's playing like this. It would explain why the eye is missing, and I'm pretty sure that vulture lurking on the tree that we showed you earlier is responsible for removing the eye. I think it might also explain why the wildebeest and the zebra are still here. They're now starting to move. Look at the lions. They're interested here. Go on. Have a fresh wildebeest. It's much nicer. You can take some credit for getting your own supper, chaps. Lions, of course, the ultimate scavengers. You may think that a hyena is, but lions are just as adept at scavenging as hyenas are, especially male lions. So this is I don't think it's the first time they've been at this carcass, because certainly the lioness that we first saw seemed to have blood on her chin. But it would also explain why they just kind of left it, and I think it would also explain the swelling in the belly there. Who knows? I'll tell you what else my theory is, or why, what else supports this, is that the fact that the bottom there under the tail, can you see that, Jandre, has been eaten away, but almost kind of in a half-hearted fashion. That doesn't look like a lion bite to me. That looks like a vulture's tried to get in there. That's not where lions normally eat from. They'd normally eat from the belly. I think the mystery of the zebra has now been solved. Ooh, there's a snake eagle. Are you going to shoot it, Jandre? Thank you. The other day, everybody, I told Jandre to shoot a rufous-bellied heron that flew over the the crossing site that where we were, and Graham got very cross. He said, you can't look at a rufous-bellied heron where there are zebra and wildebeest streaming across the river. I mean, I suppose he had a fair point, but I hadn't seen a rufous-bellied heron for some time. Now, these animals are moving off, and I don't know where they're going to go. They seem, much like the wildebeest at the crossings, to be in two minds. So they go south or north. Donald, do you want to know what the biggest bird of prey out here is? I'm going to say, Donald, in the absence of a Cape vulture, which I don't think they get here, a leopard-faced vulture would be the largest bird of prey that we find in this area. Probably about 7, 8 or 9 kilos, perhaps, which is a very big flying bird. Not quite the size of an Andean condor, but pretty close to it. Well, these zebras are coming closer and closer. I'm just going to get down off my perch and stand. You may also be able to hear the gentle revving of an engine. That is somebody who is now stuck in for a long night. We mustn't laugh at their misfortune, of course, because it would be very easy to do the same thing. All right, we're going to stay here and see what plays out here. We obviously do want to have some kind of a hunting sequence this evening. So we'll decide whether we're going to stay with this lot and the wildebeest that are now streaming past them, or if we're going to go back towards the Kitchwatembo Pride. In the meantime, while we make up our minds, let's head across to Brent Leo Smith, who is on Cheetah Plains with his own wildebeest. Yes, Graham.
Directly in front of us, a lion is emerging.
A lion is emerging from directly in front of us. Graham is a very, very talented, because he can tell that one pixel you can see there on your screen is a lion. Much as I'd love to say, don't be ridiculous, at this stage I think I actually might concur with him. That will make it twice in one day that we have had a concurrence.
Which is scary. What does it mean?
It's frightening. I don't know that it's healthy. I also cannot see anything with my binoculars. It is an invisible lion, giving only a heat signature, rather like that rather dreadful movie, Predator.
Heat signature's also been drastically reduced.
Well, that will normally happen if it goes behind a bush, I imagine. Graham says the heat signature has been drastically reduced by it going behind a bush. I can hear some bats going. What do you think, Graham? You want to go and look? It's somewhere around those two trees there, everybody, that you can see there.
It's moving slightly east.
It's moving east now. To the left of that, Jandri. Go to the left of that, left of the tree on there, the left of that. Yeah, if you zoom in there, that's where I believe it to be.
Right of that.
Hey?
Of where Jandre is looking?
Yes.
No, it's to the right of that.
Sorry, Jandre, it's to the right of the vulture tree.
Yeah.
Oh, I see, okay.
Right,
I'm with you now. So, it's very difficult to tell what on earth our fearless leader is pointing his thermal camera at, because he's in the back of the car. It's a very big thing coming towards us. It is a very big and completely invisible thing coming towards us. Ah, there it is. You might want to pan left.
Not that bird,
no. Those things of which we do not speak. Jandre? Now, for when many of you on Safari Live, you will know that there are certain things of which we do not speak, and that was one of them. So if you're wondering, everyone, we have a policy of not showing rhinoceros on Safari Live. That is because of the poaching scourge. It's large in South Africa, not so much up here, but we're not going to show rhino. And rather than play that we don't know what that was. It was a rhino going down into the woodland there. Now, Remy, you say, is this typical activity of the big cats, and you're a new viewer. Remy, I'm just going to give you a quick update as to what we think happened here. This is not typical behavior, but this is a migration season. In fact, so between July and October in this area, there are a huge number of animals that aren't here for the rest of the year. Large numbers of wildebeest, zebra, Thompson's gazelles, and eland. Now, we don't think that this zebra was killed by these lions. We think it was killed, well, eventually by a crocodile. So you can see its guts are hanging out there. That is unusual, and what we think happened is that it was grabbed by a crocodile, broke the skin, it came wandering up here, and eventually died on its own. The reason we think that is that the eye is missing, there was a vulture sitting nearby, and that clearly some evidence of a vulture trying to get in to the flesh through the bottom. And that these cats are lying next to it is, I don't know if it's typical for this area, but I'm going to say that when there is a migration, during migration season, when there is such a massive amount of food in this area, I'm going to say that to call anything typical behavior would be a mistake. I think these cats might eat the zebra. They may go hunting later. We think there could be a male lion, three male lions around here somewhere. That's what Graham is searching for with the thermal imaging camera now. So, I mean, they don't look like they've fed recently because they're not full. They would definitely have fed sometime in the last week or so, well, probably in the last few days, because there's so much for them to eat at the moment. So the fact that they're lying down next to an imminently eatable carcass, well, I'm going to say it's quite strange, but perhaps for migration season it isn't. I'm also going to say to you that I wonder if the zebra didn't die of an infection, as well as having its guts sort of hanging out there. And the reason I say that is that if a crocodile and its foul, rotten, flesh-bespattered teeth got into the guts of that zebra, you can almost be certain that it would be infected with some horrendous bacteria. So when it came down here and flopped down dead, you might find that the flesh is so infected that these lions are put off it. Now that's not, I mean, lions will eat very rotten flesh, but you might find that this is just a little bit, I don't know, maybe there's something in there that they don't like. They've had a bit of a go at the ear there, you can see. All right, we're going to sit here, not a particularly pretty picture at this stage. We're going to figure out what these lions are doing. We may move on to the Kitratembo Pride at some stage, but in the meantime, let's go across and see how our old pal, the great prince of Juma, Tingana, is doing.